Thank you. Good morning and welcome again, everyone. This is Teresa Goddard from the Job Accommodation Network. I'm the lead consultant for assistive technology services here at JAN. If you didn't know, JAN is a service of the U.S. Department of Labor's Office of Disability Employment Policy. And I'm here to talk to you about AT Update. What's new in 2022? There's a lot of great stuff to talk about today. If you feel comfortable to use the raise hand icon or to just start your video and wave at me, that's completely fine. I'm happy to take questions and comments throughout. I do not mind being interrupted, but I will try to save some time at the end for burning questions. And also, if you like putting things in the chat box, questions and comments, I will try to keep an eye on that, but I can't promise I'll see everything right away. In the chat box, I did put a Dropbox link where you can download your own copy of today's slides if you would like. So without further ado, let's move on to the next slide. Okay, so on my screen, it's still showing slide one. Are you guys still seeing slide one? Okay, there we go. So first today, I'd like to give you a little roadmap of what we'll be talking about. For those of you who don't know, JAN's been around since about 1983, and we're going to talk with you a little bit about the Job Accommodation Network for those who might not be familiar. We're also going to talk a little bit about how assistive technology is defined at JAN, because the way we think of it might be a little bit different from the way other organizations think about it. I'm going to speak a little bit about the interactive process and some situations and solutions where assistive technology can be applied. And then we're going to talk about some exciting new AT in development. Okay, so if you did not know, JAN is a free consultation service that helps people with disabilities and people who are trying to employ people with disabilities understand job accommodations, federal employment-related disability rights laws, the resources that a person with a disability can tap into to start a small business, and many more other disability and employment-related topics. We've been around since 1983, so a little bit longer than the ADA. We have one office located on the campus of West Virginia University, but we provide our services to the entire United States and the territories. So if you have any questions, we'll be happy to help in any way that we can. So sometimes we get questions that aren't directly related to disability or assistive technology or even employment. But if somebody asks us any type of question that is anything close to what we do, we try to find them an answer if at all possible. And anybody's free to contact us. You know, I say we serve the US and the territories, but we get emails from all over the world as well. Okay, so next I want to talk a little bit about what we mean when we say assistive technology at the Job Accommodation Network specifically. So there's a little bit of debate, I feel, within the disability and assistive technology communities on this. So I just want to share with you what we think of that as here at JAN. To us, AT or assistive technology means any sort of service or device that helps a person with a disability to achieve or maintain functioning. So some people prefer to limit the term to mean only things that are designed to help people with high needs, but we feel that assistive technology can also be simple. It could even be the kinds of ubiquitous things that are just in our environment that a person with a disability could also use to improve function. So on this slide, we have a couple of examples pictured. If you will look at the slide, you'll see an example of speech recognition software. We see a Nuance Dragon Home. Of course, they also have business editions. There is a picture of a compact material handling device and a picture of an alternate input device, an alternate keyboard in this case. So this one is a type of touchscreen that could be used by a person who maybe has difficulty using a typical mouse or keyboard, or who just finds this type of interface a little bit easier to use. Okay, any questions so far? If not, I'm gonna keep plowing right along. So, and next we're going to talk about some traditional forms of assistive technology as well as some more mainstream devices. So practically speaking, there are some good reasons to separate more traditional forms of AT and more mainstream devices. I feel, for instance, traditional assistive technology tends to be devices that are designed to complete a specific task specifically for a person with a disability. So they tend to be more specialized pieces of equipment and might have only one or two intended functions. So like, for example, Microsoft specially designed adaptive controller for Xbox users is pictured on the left of this slide. And that's really designed for Xbox access and nothing else. Meanwhile, mainstream devices like computers and cell phones or iPads, we have an iPhone, for instance, pictured here, are more mainstream devices that are designed to be useful to a much wider audience, but they can definitely be helpful to people with disabilities, even though they're not specifically designed for their needs. I think the key here, though, is that accessibility in mainstream devices has become a much more prominent concern of late. And because of that, we have built-in accessibility features for these devices that are available just as soon as you open the box. Features like speech recognition, word prediction, color contrasting, and many more are now standard features. And because of this, the line that defines traditional assistive technology and mainstream devices gets more and more blurred as we go on. In a sense, the goals of traditional assistive technology are being incorporated into our everyday technologies. And because of that, at JAN, we see both forms of AT. I can remember going to CSUN years ago when things like word prediction were being sold as separate software products. And now they're built into so many of our devices. So again, when we think of assistive technology, a lot of us think of those really high-tech futuristic devices, things that maybe even we saw in sci-fi movies when we were a kid, rather than just simple modifications. So sometimes assistive technology is like that. Okay, so on the screen, we have a picture of people meeting where three people are communicating with a coworker through a robotic telepresence device. That's a newer technology that could be useful for someone who works remotely while still needing some type of physical presence on site. So at JAN, we're seeing this not only used in the workplace, but in some cases, it's also being used in schools where students who have immune system issues that might prevent them from participating in classes can still be present in a sort of simulated physical way. It allows them to have some of the benefits of physical presence while still having the protection of telepresence. So that's an example of a very, very high-tech type of assistive technology. And some other typical examples include alternative input devices, specialized software options like screen reading software, things that read the screen aloud to us, or also software that turns voice into text, which is what I use for most of my typing every day. AAC devices, also known as speech generating devices, would also be a form of high tech. Some low-tech type modifications could include things like workspace modifications, less expensive devices like a pencil grip. Workplace modifications can be made at little to no cost, and there are all sorts of really inexpensive things like gripping aids or things that could be modified. For instance, AT could be as simple as wrapping a handling duct tape to make it easier to grasp, or removing the legs of a computer desk. That could be a very low-cost accommodation for someone with short stature. So there's the basics, and I won't spend too much time on this because I know you all love AT and have probably heard this many, many times. I do want to take a brief moment, though, to talk about some of the events that JAN does try to attend, like today's event with ATAC. We will also be attending ATIA 2023 as well as the CSUN conference in 2023. We're not going to be at Closing the Gap this year, but it's a great conference. And if you have the opportunity, I definitely encourage you to go. Next, we're going to talk about how to find your path when you're selecting between different types of assistive technologies. There are all different kinds of ways to do this. So I'm going to share some examples from Jan case data so that you can kind of get a feel for how we do it at Jan. Okay, so first, I want to discuss a typical vision issue. So in a case at Jan, a new hire had just begun working in a school cafeteria, and she had low vision and had been working with a team of professionals to learn how to use strategies and assistive technologies for on-the-job tasks. So let's talk about some typical solutions for this type of issue. The worker explained to her new supervisor how she could use some assistive technology and strategies that she was aware of to perform tasks like serving students, cleaning tables, navigating the kitchen and the cafeteria, putting away the cleaning products. But when she was on the job on the first day, she had some initial difficulty navigating. And of course, that's not unusual in a new space. So some typical solutions for assistance with navigating could include things like allowing an orientation and mobility specialist to come to the workplace to help her practice her navigation skills in that specific environment and perhaps pick up some new skills if necessary. Orientation and mobility tools such as canes and proximity detectors can be helpful for people with individuals who are trained in their appropriate use. So even though I mentioned them here, I don't suggest just purchasing one for someone who's not trained on how to use it properly. Designing things like set paths of travel could also help. And service animals wouldn't typically be permitted in a commercial kitchen, but it's possible that somebody might use their service animal to get to and from their work site and to navigate other parts of their work site, just not the kitchen. So sometimes if a person is a service animal user doing this type of work, you might need to figure out some type of solution for the service animal. So those are some typical things that run through my mind when I encounter this type of scenario. Okay, so we're going to talk about a range of approaches for a solution of this type. Okay, I'm going to take a quick look at the chat box. Okay, if there's something urgent that I miss, please feel free to interrupt me. That's totally fine. So I want to next talk about just a range of typical solutions for this type of scenario. So some typical options would be, let's say the person has some type of assistive technology and the employer is concerned that it might be damaged if it gets wet It might not be safe to use in a specific environment like a kitchen. The employer could, for instance, look for an accessible location to store that. So it can take some trial and error to identify the solutions that will meet the employee's needs and satisfy the employer's requirements and concerns. An assistive technology evaluation, either by a vision rehabilitation therapist or a CATIS, C-A-T-I-S, might be helpful. Other professionals such as occupational therapists, vocational rehabilitation therapists might be able to assist and identify accommodation options as well. Asking the individual what they've used previously is a great strategy too. And this concern about something getting damaged, especially if it's a high-tech piece of equipment, is actually a pretty common concern. And in a kitchen, there can also be concerns about contaminating the food surfaces. So that's why we talk about finding a secure and accessible location. Designating someone to assist as a qualified reader might also be a good idea, even if the person has assistive technology to help them do things like read labels and use the computer, because there could be times when, for whatever reason, the assistive technology might temporarily not be working. So in this case, there were a lot of concerns about the person's ability to reliably make sure she was picking out the correct cleaning product and putting it back in the correct place. Because especially in commercial kitchens, a lot of cleaning products are really necessary and they're very strong. There can be big consequences if those are stored incorrectly or used incorrectly. I mean, recently there was a case in the news where someone accidentally served milk that had gotten contaminated with a cleaning product, presumably because of some sort of storage problem. So another thing that you might wind up doing is seek assistance from a vocational rehabilitation office or from a scripting vendor. So why might you need to use this in a school kitchen? Well, part of her job was going to include maintaining inventory, keeping records on temperatures, and also taking lunch cards and making sure that that things related to the lunch card transactions were happening correctly. Some portable AT options that can be very useful if there's a concern about sitting things down in the wrong spot include the ORCAM, which we heard about previously today, an optical character recognition device that's really small and available in something that you can wear attached to your eyeglass temples. IRA.io is an app, but they're also starting a project, I understand, with Envision. Whereas they used to be glasses and they became an app, it looks like they're going to have some partnerships that allow them to get back into wearables again, possibly. Portable digital magnifiers could potentially be worn on a lanyard if small enough. And seeing AI is another option for reading things like labels. Seeing AI also works on handwriting, but not everybody's handwriting. So for instance, I have an issue with my dominant hand. It won't read my handwriting, but it reads most of my coworkers. Okay, moving right along. Okay. So again, this employer had really specific concerns about identifying the cleaning chemicals, and they really wanted to make sure that lunch numbers were going to be handled correctly and that the employee would appropriately use assistive technology in the kitchen. I want to tell you about one thing related to IRA.io. They're also currently beta testing a desktop app that allows virtual sighted assistance for computer-based tasks. So if you have someone who might benefit from sighted assistance, but an in-person qualified reader is not available, that's something that might be suitable. But I'm always in favor of having a qualified reader available as a backup option, even if it's just a coworker who's available once in a while as needed. I want to move on to our next example because, time just keeps running on. For our next example, we have an individual working in the healthcare industry who only has use of one hand and is having difficulty using a computer. So the employer reached out to us here at JAN to see if we could suggest some accommodation options that might benefit this individual. So up to that point, the individual was just kind of switching back and forth using the standard mouse and the standard keyboard with one hand. And this was causing the individual to work at a much slower pace than other people in the same role. So the employer was contacting us, hoping that we might have something that could get them to move a little bit faster. So some typical accommodations for an individual with use of only one hand who is having issues with typing could include acquisition of a specially designed one-hand keyboard, like the pictured model from Maltron on this slide on the left. So unlike a standard QWERTY keyboard, it's laid out a little differently, so it's more ergonomic to type only with one hand. But if you're going to apply an option like this, there is a learning curve. It takes time to learn how to use it quickly. And so you'll see here that some keys have been moved and omitted. So it can be difficult to learn how to use this quickly. For the right person, this could be a great accommodation, but a lot of people are going to have trouble getting used to this. Some people prefer miniature keyboards because the layout's a little more familiar and they feel like they can learn it a little more quickly. Speech recognition software, though, does give you a great deal of speed for the investment. And for me personally, that's what I prefer, although I also use an adaptive keyboard. I think it's very important to give people a chance to try different options. And if you're considering voice recognition software, give them plenty of time and support to learn how to use that effectively. There's a learning curve, but once you get the hang of it, it's very, very quick. So in this case, the individual agreed that speech recognition was the best option. They wanted to proceed with that as the accommodation, but they worked with sensitive information that needed to be kept confidential, and there was concern about it being overheard. Fortunately, there is a solution for this. In a case like this, you might want to look into a steno mask. We have one pictured on the left. These are specially designed microphones that have an attachment that the user presses against their face to help dampen their voice and keep it from being overheard by others. So you might have seen these in courtrooms. You might need a USB adapter to use this with some types of computers. So in addition, there are some other accommodations that could be provided as an alternative or in addition. Letting somebody work from home might be a simple solution if that meets the data security requirements. Working out of a private room in their home might be okay. If teleworking is not an option, you could try a private office on site. And there are various types of noise abatement materials like soundproof panels that could potentially be used to help dampen sound. Next slide, please. I also want to show you the Calla Trio. This is a wrist-worn simulator that can help with typing or writing tasks for people who have tremors. So while you're wearing it, it monitors for tremors, and if it detects one, it sends out a little electrical signal to help dampen the effects of the tremor. So it's pretty new. It's only been on the market since 2019, but it is cleared by the FDA for treating tremors. So I wanted to make sure that you knew about this one today. Now, one caution would be anybody who's considering this would want to speak to their doctor if they have anything implanted in their body that could be affected by electrical signals, like a pacemaker, or if somebody has a history of seizures. They would definitely want to speak to a physician before considering something like this. Next, we're going to talk about a hearing issue. A newly hired roofer was deaf, usually used ASL, and he needed to receive work instructions at the work site. So typically, when somebody needs ASL, interpreting services is pretty much the gold standard, right? It's really important to assure effective communication. Now, sometimes an employee might be able to use other things like automated captioning or something like texting or instant messaging and even handwritten notes. A lot of people like a whiteboard. So here I have some basic tips if you want to download the slide deck later and you want to see some basic tips for communicating through a sign language interpreter. We have some here. One of the most important things you can do is choose an effective interpreter. Relax, use your normal tone and speed, and make sure that you're interacting directly with the deaf individual. So sometimes though, the typical accommodations just aren't a good fit. It's really common when the work setting is unusual. This roofer needed to receive instructions on site, and they were constantly changing locations. It was hard to find an interpreter that could meet the employee's need. And certain things like, you know, could you use a UB Duo on top of a roof? I think it might be pretty challenging. Also, there were concerns about the fact that some of the locations were kind of remote. So you might not be able to use things like texting, even if it was practical in that location. So really interesting case. I enjoyed working on it, but it was pretty challenging. So what we did was we discussed a range of low-tech and high-tech communication supports that didn't require connectivity because they weren't going to have good access to internet or data signals from a cell phone system. So some of the good old options work great. Pen and paper, a whiteboard if you need it to be bigger. One of the best things that I think would work here is not AT, but if the supervisor would would be willing to learn some basic signs, that would be great. We also talked about SignTel, but unfortunately it looks like it's pretty hard to get a hold of them now. I'm not sure if the SignTel product is still on the market, but that was a voice recognition system that turned spoken English into a rudimentary form of sign language. All right, moving on, because we are running out of time. An employee working for the IRS was recently in a car accident and injured their back. The employer reached out to Jan seeking accommodation options to help this individual with pain. They really had a problem with sitting for a long time. So, one of the common accommodations for this would be an adjustable workstation that can be raised and lowered, a height adjustable monitor stand with an attached keyboard and mouse tray so that everything goes up and down kind of in the same way and at the same ratio can be really helpful here. A dedicated sitting workstation and a separate dedicated standing workstation could also work. And if you have the space to do that, then sometimes you can come up with something that's a bit more customized. I know one issue that I had when I used a sit-stand workstation was that because I need to have my arm at a particular angle in order to be comfortable, it was really hard to find a desk that would give me good comfort in both positions. So this individual's pain was not relieved. So what if the individual's pain is not relieved by alternating between sitting and standing? Sometimes that happens. So in this case, the employee stated that moving between sitting and standing wasn't going to help. They only get relief when they lie down. This is from an injury, so leave time might have worked to give them time to recover. But a lot of people prefer to minimize their use of leave if possible, just for financial reasons. So a zero gravity reclining chair allows sitting in an upright posture and alternating to the supine position as needed. So there are models that will use a motor to do this so that the chair remains in a static position until you change it on purpose. So something like that could be helpful. There are supine workstations though that are designed to make sure that the computer moves with you. So it's like a whole workstation package. So here we have in this picture, the AltWork Flex Station on the left of this slide. And it's an entire workstation bundled into one. I do want to talk about a modification for pain and back injuries. The Esco Evo is a newer product, and it's designed to reduce your chance of developing an injury. But some people who have had an injury may also be helped by it. It's an exoskeleton vest that helps to reduce worker fatigue by providing support when they're doing tasks like lifting. So how this works is the bottom part gets strapped around your waist, and there are two parts at the top to help support your arms and shoulders. It doesn't provide any electrical support. It's not motorized, but it uses resistance so that you can do lifting and carrying with a little less effort. So that was released in 2020. It's still pretty new, and that's why we're including it today. Okay, so I just want to touch briefly on some accommodation trends. One thing that we're seeing at Jan is increased concern about data security from employers. So people are getting pushback on some types of accommodations that used to be readily implemented. Things especially like adaptive software, like screen reading software. We're still seeing a lot of questions about hybrid work, but we're also seeing a lot of employers who would like everybody to be returning to the workplace. So there's a little bit of tension. I would say in terms of accommodation trends right now, with a lot of people who've really enjoyed hybrid work or telework or found it beneficial for their health condition, or maybe they've even had their health condition exacerbated during the pandemic while at home, and they would prefer to work at home. Meanwhile, employers are having this increased concern about data security. And we're seeing some employers strongly trying to urge people back to the physical workplace, even people that have been doing great with telework. So that's a trend that I'm a little disappointed to see, but that's what's happening. I want to talk a little bit about some ATN development before I let you go and before we open it up to questions. So the Cognition One, I'm so excited about this product. I first saw it at CSUN just at the beginning of this year. This is a wearable AAC device that also has an AR display, and you can choose between three different methods of access. They do have different models. I don't think all of them have the brain-computer interface, but the three options that you have for selecting what it is that you want to say include switch, head pointing, but this is one of the first commercial devices where we've seen brain-computer interface. What's exciting about this is in their user trials, they're seeing really, really impressive gains in speed of method selection so that people are able to get what it is that they want to say spoken through the speech generating device really quickly. It's very, very exciting. I want to talk a little bit about this because we're still seeing people wearing masks, either for protection from things like flus, COVID, other viruses, and also people with fragrance sensitivity are starting to feel a little more comfortable wearing a mask at work just because people have been masking for a few years now, and people have been reporting to Jan that they feel a little bit less self-conscious than they did in some cases. So I want to tell you about this honeycomb pollution mask from I Can Breathe Masks. It's a mask and filter combo that features a reusable washable shell. That's the peach colored part that the person is wearing on their face. And there's also a replaceable filter that contains activated carbon. So it's designed to really to reduce exposure to smoke, sort of acrid air, dust pollution, fragrances, fumes. It can be used for many types of allergens, but you probably wouldn't be using this if you're allergic to coconut or tree nuts. I'd say certainly if somebody has a tree nut allergy, they would want to check with a doctor. If you're allergic to coconuts, I wouldn't wear it because the carbon in it is based on a coconut filter. Okay, this is another exciting product that we've only recently become aware of at Jan. It's called the Speak C. And it is it's a two-part product, really. There is a software-based portion that is used for captioning. And what's nice about it is it's pretty good at differentiating between different speakers. But the really exciting part is the Speak C microphone system that comes with a couple of little satellite microphones that you can pick up out of their little case and set at various points around the table. And then what this does is it picks up somebody's voice, you can stream it into a hearing aid, and you can also view, using an app on a phone, a live transcript of what's being said. But the thing that makes this different from some other products is each microphone is color-coded so that you can get a feel for who's speaking in the meeting. It's a little bit easier to follow than a transcript where it's kind of just a bunch of words. I want to talk a little bit too about Osser. They've released a new motorized leg prosthesis that came out in February this year. It's called the Power Knee, and it provides increased stability when descending slopes and stairs, but also some increased power when walking, standing up, and climbing. Okay, we have a few minutes left. Would anybody like to say anything either in the chat or just by unmuting and asking your question? So I do want to tell you, Jan does have a series of web trainings. So if you're interested, you can go to the Jan website and see what's coming up. Anyone can also contact Jan for a free consultation. If you have any questions about today's presentation, I'd be happy to take those by email. My email is goddard@jan.wvu.edu. Again, that's G-O-D-D-A-R-D at J-A-N.wvu.edu. But you can also use the email address jan@askjan.org anytime you have a question. You can also submit questions through social media, through Jan Chat on our website, or by calling us at 800-526-7234. We also have an extensive website at askjan.org. I will say too, somebody did ask me recently, what if you feel like something like Signtel is the right fit for your client because you don't have to have the internet connectivity? I've had difficulty finding secondhand options on eBay. Sometimes that's where I go if I can't find something through the original vendor, but it's pretty scarce even there. I would say that AT reuse projects are probably your best bet. Hey, sorry about that. I had a little video blip. Yes, I see a comment in the chat. The Cognition One, very exciting. I've been watching this brain-computer interface research for several years. It's so exciting to see a product that's actually, I would say they're probably in alpha testing now rather than beta testing. But what's really exciting to me is that some of their testers have cerebral palsy, and traditionally researchers have found it difficult to use brain-computer interface in some cases with adults with cerebral palsy just because of mapping issues. But apparently it's working well. It's gonna be really exciting to see what else comes out in this area. And, you know, I thought that having the Cognition be in a goggle AR format was going to be awkward, but it actually is kind of neat how it works because it looks like the person is wearing almost like ski goggles, but because of the AR technology, they can also see sort of an augmented reality through the goggles, which is nice. Seeing a lot of work too on virtual reality for use in special education classrooms. So I think that could be a game changer in terms of preparing people for like daily life tasks and preparing people for the workplace. I think that's gonna be exciting for any classroom, not only special ed. Any other questions or comments? So I'd like to go up and talk a little bit more about the OSER since we have a little bit of time. So again, it does have a motor in it. So the way it can provide some increased power and stability when going down a flight of stairs or walking down a slope is really interesting, but that motor also provides increased power when you're climbing up the stairs. So what I like about this is that it's dynamic. It shifts between providing resistance when you need it and providing power when you need it. One thing that we'll often hear from people who use prosthetic legs is that it can be very difficult to do something simple like standing up from a seated position because the prosthetic really doesn't have the same support and structure as a natural leg. But with the motor included, they're able to shift a little bit more easily and make that shift from sitting to standing in a more stable way. I think that's one of the most interesting features of the OSER is the way it provides both. So again, here's the power knee. And just to go back to the speak see a little bit, one of the first products where we were able to use our own phones to receive captioning was Ava, that's spelled A-V-A. And when it first came out, it was absolutely revolutionary, still a great product, and it's available in the desktop version too. It was so nice that people could use their own microphones to participate in a conversation with their own phone, and that the person receiving captions was able to receive that really easily. So that is still a really good option, especially for the smaller group meetings, because multiple people can participate. But if you don't want to have everybody at the meeting be sure to bring their device, then something like the Speaksy might be more appropriate. I want to go back up to trends just a little bit. So one thing that we have seen with the data security trend in particular is that during work from home, some people are finding that certain types of assistive software use so many resources that it can be really challenging to use them over a VPN, or the base computers that they're getting for their work at home might not be powerful enough to support them. So they might want to try something that's written a little bit lighter. So for instance, some people who have gotten along with Zoom text for years have said they're having problems with it, just not being quite as fast and as nimble as they need for their work at home experience. But when they try to switch to a different option, they run into problems from their data security team. Not that other options are less secure, but they're less well known. So it can take time to get something cleared. And there are certain things that we used to be able to have for testing purposes at JAN that under our new data security policy, we're not allowed to have on our computers that face the internet anymore. So that's certainly been an issue. Another big issue that we're facing at JAN in terms of our calls and the trends on those is that there used to be some really good options for captioning that didn't require any connection to the internet whatsoever. So the initial InterpreType products were like this, but recently they changed to be cloud-based, and now InterpreType is out of business and no longer taking orders. I've had a lot of questions from people looking for something that will do captioning for a meeting without being connected to the internet. And the options are really limited, and those limited options seem like they're going out of business really quickly. So that's been a big concern of mine recently. It's a development that I wish I didn't have to talk about. The other thing that we're seeing is that hybrid work, even though sometimes an employer might say that a position is hybrid, sometimes it's really not as hybrid as you would hope. That's been something that we're hearing from the employee side. They were offered a position where they thought they were going to be working from home, say, most of the time, maybe 3 to 4 days a week, but the employer actually wants them in more. So that's been a big concern. It's almost like a bait and switch type situation. And I do understand it from the employer perspective, because sometimes you might realize after the fact that you need the person on site more than you thought you would, but it's really difficult for people who were actually hoping for more work from home. And again, this return to the workplace thing, it's been challenging. The shift to remote and hybrid work brought a lot of challenges because, well, in the case of hearing-related accommodations, the biggest thing that we saw was nobody was using standard phones anymore. So all of the solutions that were really simple plug and play solutions for landline phones, there was suddenly no interest in them. And in fact, some of the AT companies that I've been talking about for years have gone out of business because that was their primary market. So there was a pivot to try to find things for voice over IP systems really quickly. And that's just a little bit more complicated because it depends not only on your VoIP system, it depends if you have the type of VoIP phone that sits on a desk physically or is totally on the computer. And also it depends what type of computer you're using because the ports have to be just right for certain types of headsets. That's been a big concern with the pivot to remote or hybrid work. The other thing I've seen that's kind of disappointing is that a lot of times employers are purchasing software with accessibility features that are really, really great, but then they're not turning them on, sometimes because there's an extra fee for turning on the accessibility feature, or because they would have to turn the feature on for everybody and they can't toggle it on for one person. So we see this with automated captioning within meeting software. Sometimes the technology is available, but the employer lacks the flexibility in their contracts to turn it on for one or two individuals, and they lack the budget to turn it on for everyone. So that's really an example of where contracts and budgets can interfere with the implementation of an accommodation. So again, if you have any questions or comments at all, please drop them in the chat box. And you can also send questions after the fact to jan@askjan.org or to goddard@jan.wvu.edu. It's been a pleasure to be with you here today. I always love coming to this particular event, and I really enjoyed what I was able to see of today's events. Hope to be back in person with you next year. So again, there is the Jan phone number and website and all of our points of contact right here on this screen. AskJan.org does have an extensive website where you can see solutions for different types of assistive technology. You can choose from things like decibel meters, personal assistive listening devices, and see vendors and product examples for those. Again, thank you so much for being here today. I think that's a wrap.